Hello and welcome everyone to our latest presentation on mechanical ventilation in COVID-19 pneumonia. Now this is being revisited after 1 year. We will review the literature that has been come out and how we can more tailor our ventilatory strategy for COVID-19 ARDS. ARDS, as we know, has multiple etiologies like pneumonia, sepsis, inhalational injury and other causes. It usually results in edema formation and baby lung, which reduces the gas exchange, affects the lung mechanics and hemodynamics, resulting in a mechanical ventilatory support. Now, what we need to know is this what happens in COVID-19 pneumonia? Is it same, or we can do some different ventilatory strategy for COVID-19? Now, in traditional ARDS that we know, it is usually because of the inflammatory edema. So as the non-aerated tissue increases, the PF ratio also decreases, which is reflected in these type of studies. As the amount of non-aerated tissue is increasing, the PF ratio is also going down. Similarly with extravascular lung water, as the extravascular lung water increases, the severity of the ARDS also increases. Is this the same thing which happens in COVID-19? Not really. In the initial stages of COVID-19, the hypoxia can also be because of the dysfunction in the pulmonary perfusion. Though in most cases it is because of an immunothrombosis, but this is also not something which is seen in all cases. There are a lot of cases where you do not see a thrombosis, yet there is a perfusion defect. So there is some amount of neoangiogenesis, vascular abnormality resulting in more shunts. This can be one of the main things which is causing hypoxemia in these patients. Now, the problem with COVID-19 is that, as we see, there is a severe lung involvement, but the problem is the perfusion is preferentially going into these areas, while the normal ventilated areas are not getting adequate perfusion, thereby resulting in hypoxia. Again, a similar type of study which shows the glucose metabolism, and again, as we can see, it is these inflammatory areas which are giving higher perfusion. So 59% of the lung perfusion is going to the inflamed lung tissue, while the adequately ventilated lung is getting only 41%. So there is a hypoxia in these patients. Now, this was a study which was done in the lung safe population. In this, they, after the idea of COVID-19 into the L type and H type, they went back and studied the population and divided into L type and H type. And they found that in the L type, the tidal volume that was being given was 8.5, while in the H type, which is the traditional ARDS, the tidal volume that was being delivered is 7.5. So if we ideally think, then the chance of villi is higher in this population. However, if you look closely into the driving pressures, the driving pressure in the L type was only 7.6, while in the H type it was 17.34. So it means that even though this group was getting higher tidal volume, the chance of developing villi was less because the delta P was less. Now this is something which we should keep in mind, especially in the early stages of COVID-19 pneumonia. The L type, we can give higher tidal volumes and still have lower driving pressure and low risk of villi. Now, again, if we look in terms of whether to give a good tidal volume or respiratory rate, what should we alter if the patient is having an issue? If the compliance is good, represented here in the blue line, if you increase the tidal volume, the actual mortality rate reduces. However, if you decrease the tidal volume, the mortality rate is increasing. This may not be the case in severe form of ARDS when the compliance has come down. Here, as you increase the tidal volume, the mortality is increasing. So in this cases, you have to alter the respiratory rate of the patient to reduce the power. Now, mechanical power is something which is used as a composite score for showing how much energy is being given by the ventilator and resulting in lung injury. So its main component are tidal volume, respiratory rate, PEEP, flow and driving pressure. As we have seen, we have already dealt with the tidal volume and respiratory rate part. If the compliance is good, we can go for high tidal volumes. If the compliance is bad, we have to increase the rate to deal with the PCO2. However, regarding the PEEP, in low PEEP condition, the delta P is higher, as you can see over in this example. But once you increase the PEEP, the delta P is low. So we may have an impression because the driving pressure is less, the willy is less. However, PEEP per se causes lung injury. So the power of the lung in both the cases, if you see, it is 17.6 with low PEEP and 24.5 with high PEEP. So just giving the PEEP and lowering the driving pressure doesn't protect the lung. It can still damage your lung. So we must titrate your PEEP accordingly. Now, as we have seen in our practice and also in studies, that the chance of having recruitment by giving PEEP in COVID-19 pneumonia is very less. Here we can see that 32 cases were non-recruiters, while only 10 were recruiters. And if we see as to who is having these type of behavior in terms of PEEP response, here you can see that the delay to symptoms and the delay to ICU admission and intubation, as the duration increases, the chance of responding to the PEEP also decreases. It is the patients who are getting admitted early and getting ventilated early are showing some response to PEEP. As the disease is progressing into the fibrotic stage, there is a very minimal response to PEEP. Now, this study shows how PEEP causes volute trauma. Here, static volute trauma may lead to lung inflammation. Here we can see that the atelec trauma, the energy that is produced is less. However, if you look in terms of PEEP, if you increase the PEEP, the inflammatory response is increasing, which could be a major reason for ventilator-induced lung injury. These patients have a high respiratory drive because of hypoxia and hypercapnia. Apart from that, the inflammation of the lungs because of COVID-19 can be a very important factor for increased respiratory drive. So if you are finding high respiratory drive, even if the patient is on ventilator, can develop PCL. So to reduce this, you have to use neuromuscular blocking agents. Now, one of the methods by which we can detect high respiratory drive is by using the P.1. In this, you can see that as the pressures increase, the chance of having a high respiratory drive is more, which means that if the P.1 is more than 4 or 5, it means that the patient is having a very high respiratory drive and you need to paralyze these patients. So to summarize, in the initial stages, the compliance is good, the recruitability is low, while the oxygenation is bad because of the thrombosis. Now, in the initial stages, the lungs is mostly good, so there is minimal recruitability. As the disease progresses, the compliance is going down, the recruitability is going up. However, the oxygenation is remaining constant. In the later stages, as the fibrosis occurs, the compliance is really reduced. The oxygenation remains the same, but again, the lung is now no more recruitable. There is no chance of recruitability. And as you can see, the PCO2 is starting to increase now. So how to titrate our ventilatory findings? Now, in the early stages, when the lung is normal and there is low edema, go for low PEEP and liberate tidal volumes. The pathology is mainly in immunothrombosis and vascular dysregulation. In the next stage, there is a high edema, which means that you can use high PEEP for recruitability and low tidal volumes. As the lung progresses into a fibrotic stage, the recruitability is gone, so low PEEP and low tidal volume. This is how you should manage the patients. Now, prone positioning is something which you can use throughout these stages as long as there is an improvement in terms of oxygenation or decrease in the pressures. Now, one of the most important thing is to note these transition points. It is when these patients transition from one phase to another, usually the complications happen during this stage. Many patients, as we may have seen, develop or improve very rapidly with the early stages of ventilatory support. These patients should be extubated only if they have a low driving pressure or low respiratory drive. if the respiratory drive is high, that is the P.1 is more than 4 to 5, do not extubate these patients. Continue them on ventilatory support. Now, in the later stages, when the lung is already fibrotic, do not try to normalize the ABGs. Accept a higher PCO2 and a low PO2 and continue with low PEEP and low tidal volume. Then maybe the patient can be weaned off at a later stage. Thank you for your patience and check our website for further information.